we studied some bit about the organic compounds, and now we come to the nomenclature of organic compounds. Nomenclature of organic compounds. Why do we need to study this as a different topic, which will seem to be quite involved? Because we have just seen that there are millions of organic compounds, and there should be some specific rule so that they are uniquely named. Okay, they are uniquely named so that if you want to draw the structure, okay, it should be uniquely drawn. There should be no room for confusion. Understand? And if there is a structure, it should be uniquely named. So it is a two-way traffic between the name and the structure. And they should be unique, so there should be no room for any doubt. Now this rule is made by an apex body at the international level called IUPAC, or you'll find this being called IUPAC as an acronym. This is International Union for Pure and Applied Chemistry. Applied chemistry. But before this body came into being, okay, before this came into being, the compounds were named based on different criteria. One of the criteria was normally the source from which something came. Okay, so formic acid was named so because came from ants. Okay, it came from ants, and ants are called formica in Greek. Okay, the citric acid came from citrus fruits. Citric acid came from citrus fruits like lemon, orange. Okay, that was one of the sources, or that was one of the major identified sources in the earlier days. We'll see, we can manufacture so many of them. Okay, fine. Similarly, we had acetic acid. So acetic acid, it came from vinegar. We named the carbon, one of the allotropes of carbon, as Buckminster Fullerene. Fullerenes, okay, this is the name normally. What is it? What kind of allotrope? 60 carbons, okay, C60, or there are 3-4 variants as well. So C60 is there in a dome-like structure. Okay, so maybe say something like that. Okay, I have not shown more, but say they are something like that. Okay, so it's a ball-like structure, closes onto itself, and it It resembles a geodesic dome. Geodesic dome in UK, which is made like this. The property of this dome is that the bigger this dome is, this is a dome without a pillar anywhere. Okay, and the property of geodesic domes is the bigger you make them, the stronger they are. So if you have to make a huge, huge canopy, huge ceiling without any support, you go for a geodesic dome. Okay, this is named as Buckminster Fuller. Okay, the architect was Buckminster Fuller. So that's why it is called Fullerenes, because it looks like that. Okay, fine. Now, some of these names were so common that the IUPAC, when it decided to give its own nomenclature to the compounds, it retained those names and accepted them as IUPAC names. So there will be alternate names for certain things. Okay, so let us look at some of the common names. Say chloroform. We have seen? No? If it is a tri-substituted, tri-halogen compound substituted, the same three halogen, then it is haloform, right? So it will be called haloform. What is a haloform? Three halogens substituted in an alkene. Halogen, right? So it is chlorine, so it becomes chloroform. Okay, and it is CHCl3. Okay. Iodoform, what should that be? CHI3, yes. They are known as haloforms. Okay. Acetone, acetic, you'll find them a lot. Acetic acid. This is what? CH3COOH. Acetone. It is CH3CO CH3. Obviously in ketone this is double bonded, but you write it as CO, right? C is double bonded to an oxygen. Okay. What else? Benzene is a common name, but it is taken in to the IUPAC. This is how benzene looks in resonance with a structure like this. We'll study a lot more about benzene than this, but this is benzene. So much so that this is represented as a circle, which tells you that this double bond keeps on shifting. Okay, this is called a Robinson circle. This is called a Robinson circle. Okay, then you have this is benzene. If an H is substituted by OH, then this is termed as phenol. Okay, if instead of this you have CH3, then it is termed toluene. Okay, if this is NH2, then it is aniline. Okay, this is aniline. If it is CH3CO, CO, CH2, CH3, this is ethyl methyl ether, ethyl methyl ether. Okay, CH3, no, ye to ketone hai na. Okay, this was ketone, so this is O. When it is O, okay, ROR-, then it becomes an ether. Okay, ROR-. When does it become an ester? ROR-, right? Fine, so these are common names and many of them have been accepted as an IUPAC by this organization, and which has set down a definite set of rules which, when followed objectively one after another, will lead you to a unique name. And when you try to decipher that name back, then you'll get a unique structure. That's what a name should be. No ambiguities. Correct? That we'll see next.